Welcome guys. So in this session we are going to learn about receiving a request via HTTP and then responding with the data. So just to demonstrate on a diagram, so usually what happens is HTTP requests are made over a web browser or through curl command, or it can be made programmatically. So HTTP, a client calls a web server via HTTP request message, and then it gets a response from the server. So that response can be anything. It can be JSON data, or it can be text data, or it can be any form of data. So in our previous example, we have created a web service and we were just listening on that web service. So we were receiving all the incoming data, and then we were merging a minimum of 5 records, and then we were generating a big flow file, and then we were proceeding that flow file to perform further action. But we were not responding anything back to the requester. So let's say in this case, we are going to imagine a scenario where people want to request for the content of a file programmatically. So in that case, they are going to request for a file over HTTP endpoint, and we need to respond with the content of the file. So whatever the data in the file, we are going to respond with that data. So for that, first I will create a process group because we want to keep our data organized. So I am naming it producing data using web service. And now I'm going to enter this process group. So the way to do this, either you can double click here or you can right click and then select enter group. So once you do that, at the bottom in the breadcrumb, you can see that now you are inside NiFi flow, and then you are inside this process group, which is called producing data using web service. So now the processor which we require to perform this use case is one is called handle HTTP request and the other one is called handle HTTP response. So I will add both of them. So I have added handle HTTP request processor. Let me also add handle HTTP response. So how handle HTTP request works is, this is similar to listen HTTP. So it receives a request, and then based on that request, it is going to create a flow file. And in that flow file, we are not going to see the content. So the only thing it will do is, it will set the attributes based on the request which has been made. Then we need to define our own logic to perform further action. And also it is our responsibility to generate a HTTP response. So handle HTTP response processor is going to do that for us. So in this case, we are expecting that handle HTTP request is going to receive a file name from a user, and in this case we are going to use a curl command to send a file name to handle HTTP request, and then we are expecting that file content is going to be fetched, and then the final output which we are going to see is that is going to be the content or actual data of that file. So as you can see, handle HTTP request is just going to handle the request, and handle HTTP response is just going to respond for the request. So we do not have any processor placed in the canvas right now, which is going to fetch the actual content of the file. So for that purpose, I'm going to add one more processor, which is called fetch file in this case. And then I will connect handle HTTP request with the fetch file. And now let's select add. And then fetch file I'll be connecting to handle HTTP response for the cases of success. And all the remaining endpoint I will be using a placeholder. Let's use funnel. For now I'm just using funnel as a placeholder. I'm not going to create any functionality here, so I'll just connecting fetch file to this funnel. And failure, not found, and permission denied relationship I'm going to redirect to this funnel. Now let's try to configure all of these processes. So let's first configure handle HTTP request. So for that, either you can double click on this processor or you can right click and then select configure. So I like the double clicking way, which is faster, but just for the demonstration so that everyone can see, I right click and then I'm going to select configure. And then you can go to properties. Now in the properties, you will see that this web service is going to listen on some port. So make sure the port number which you give here, that is something which is not already used by any other application. So here on my server, port number 8088. So probably I will give a port number 8087. And I know that this port is currently not used by any application. And in the hostname, provide the hostname on which you are going to enable this service. So in my case, I'm going to enable this service on the same server. So I'm going to provide the IP address of this server. Or here you can type localhost as well, but I'm just going to give the IP. And also remember, this is the internal IP of that server, which is also called private IP. But this can be either IP or the hostname. Or if you have installed everything on the same server, you can type localhost here. And now the most important thing which we need to do here is, that is called HTTP context map. This is a service which we need to create. So if you right click here, you will see an option to create new service. So HTTP context map is actually going to receive all the parameters and going to create attributes in this flow file. So we are going to select create new service, and then we will use standard HTTP context map. For now, if you see, there is only this service which we can create. There is no other mechanism. So we are going to use this standard HTTP context map. And also in the controller service name, you can change it to any name. This can be any name which is easily understandable or easily recognizable. Or also you can follow the naming standard policy of your project. So in my case, I'm just going to leave it to default, and then I'm going to click on create. And now you see, we also see a go to action for performing further configuration. Since this is a service, we need to perform more action by going into the controller settings. So I'll be clicking here in the go to section, and then it is asking, do we want to save the changes? Yes, we want to save the changes before going to the controller service. So I will select yes. And then it has taken us to the controller service. So in the controller service, if you see standard HTTP context map service, we are going to go to configuration. And then in the properties, if you see in the properties, there are not many options. Okay. So the only thing which you need to do here is, if you want to change the value of maximum outstanding requests, you can do that. And also you can define a request expiration. So let's say when any application request for some data, and let's say we are not getting any response from this web service within any number of minutes, and then you want that request to be expired. So you can set those things here. In my case, I'm just going to leave it to default, and then I will select apply. And also make sure you enable this service. So I'm going to enable this controller service, select enable, and then this service is going to get started. So this is typically how all the controller services works. You perform the configuration and then you start that service and then you use that service in the processor. Okay, now let's right click again on handle HTTP request and see if we want to configure any other thing. So I think that's it for now. Also probably I will set false to all the other operation other than get. So if you know about web service, you will be knowing there are many web service request can be made. It can be a get request, it can be a post request, it can be a put request, it can be delete or head request. Get request is typically when you request for something and also you expect some data in response. So I'm going to set false for all the other parameters, but this is completely optional. And also if your use case is something, let's say you want to update some data based on the request which is received. In that case, you may need to enable put or delete or post. So this is entirely based on the use case which you have. In our scenario, we just want to receive a file name and then based on that file name, we want to process that file name, we want to read the data and we want to respond back to the requester with the data. So these the settings which we have done so far, that's more than enough. Now we are going to click on apply. And now this processor is ready to use. So now to make a request to this processor, what I'm going to do is from the command prompt, I'm going to issue a curl command. So in the curl command, if you see, this is the IP address which I have, where we have run that HTTP handler service. And also if you notice, this is a public IP which I have given here. Whereas here if you notice in the hostname, I have given the private IP. The reason is because this NiFi is installed on a different system and I want to access it from outside that server. Okay, so that is the reason I need to use public IP. If you see this server is a different server, if I type hostname, you will see this is an entirely different server. So now I'm going to make this request and I'm going to hit enter. So now what it has done is, it should have created, okay. So guys, I forgot to enable this handler HTTP request. So let me start this. And now we will run this. Previously you saw it failed because we had not started or we had not enabled HTTP request handler service. So now I'm going to issue this command again. And now if I right click and select refresh, we can see we have received one flow file in the success queue. So now if you right click on this queue and then you go to list queue, you will notice that view content is disabled because we do not have any content in this flow file. The only thing which this handler HTTP request has done is it has created a flow file and in that flow file, it has set some attributes. So now if you go to attribute section, you will notice the file name which we had passed that has come under http.param.filename. So if you see here, this is the file name I have passed. And this is a way to actually create a endpoint or to pass a query filter. You don't need to bother about this much. This is something which application developer is going to do for you and he's going to give you the complete URL. Also now if you had noticed, we are getting the error saying that error 503 timeout occurred because we issued a request using curl command and we passed a file name But in our code, we are not sending any response back as of now. Okay, so we have created HTTP respond service, but we are not sending any response because that service is in disable mode. So let's go back to the screen. And now as you can see, the file name which we are sending from using curl command, that is going to be coming under HTTP param filename attribute. So what I will do is I'm going to use this attribute's value in the fetch file section. So I have copied that attribute, and now in the fetch file I'm going to right click and select configure, and in the file to fetch I will be passing this file name dynamically based on the value which is available in the handler HTTP request attribute. So HTTP param.filename is always going to give me dynamic file name which is received from the requester. And in the absolute path, I know in which directory I have kept all these files which a requester is requesting. So in my scenario, I have created a file under TMP directory and file name is called employee.csv. So if I do a cat command on this directory and on this file, okay, so let me type cat followed by /tmp/employee.csv. Now we can see this is the content which we have in this file. Okay, this is the data which we see in this file. Now what we will do is, let's change this path from absolute path to /tmp. So now the way this is going to work is, it is always going to go to /tmp directory, and in that directory it is going to go to the file name which it has received from a previous flow files attribute. So that's it in the fetch file. I do not want to change any other property. So I will click apply. And also for now, I will stop this handler HTTP request. And let's also empty the queue so we can see the example again. Okay, so what we have done so far is we have configured handle HTTP request, we have configured fetch file processor, and now we are going to configure handle HTTP response. So setting this is very simple. Right click and go to configure. The only thing which we need to do here is in the HTTP context map, you need to provide the HTTP context map service name. So here we are going to use the same service which we had created previously for handle HTTP request. So you can see by default that name is coming, so I'm going to just click OK. And in the HTTP status code, you can write the status code which you want to respond. Usually for the case of success, we always respond with a code 200. So these are the default or standard HTTP response codes. So I'm going to select 200 and going to click on OK. And now we can select apply. So now this service is ready to use. The only thing now which it is complaining about is the relationships. So let me again use a funnel as a placeholder. And then I'm going to connect this to funnel endpoint for both in case of success and also for the case of failure. Okay, so now we have generated the whole flow file and everything looks okay to me. So let's enable all of these processors one by one, or you can right click on the canvas and then you can select start, which is going to enable all the services at once. Now you can see all the processors are in starting mode. But for the sake of example, let's do one by one. Or let me just show it to you how it works and then I will explain it to you. So you can see all the services are started. Handle HTTP request is going to receive a file name, and then that file name is going to be passed to fetch file, and that fetch file is going to pass that attribute to handle HTTP response along with the content of the file. and that content of the file is going to be sent back to the requester. Let me clear the screen. So now if you see again, we are making a request using curl command on this endpoint which we have configured over the port 8087, and we have created a query string, and in that we are querying file, and this can be any name. This is just the way how query string works, so it doesn't need to be file. It can be any name which you want to specify. You can set it to path or fname or whatever. And then in the file name, and this can be any name, you can put employee.csv. So basically this is the actual file which is going to be assigned, and this is the name which we have used in the fetch file. So now I'm going to hit enter. Okay, so now once I hit enter, you can see that we have received all the data which was available in that file. And also, now let's say whenever there is any changes made in that file, you do not need to make any changes in your NiFi data flow. So now it is just going to take care of at runtime, whenever whatever content it sees in this file, it is going to bring that file and going to send it to the requester. Now to explain you what I will do is I am going to modify this file, and let's say I will delete. Okay, this file is created with a different user, so I will switch to that user because this user doesn't have permission to modify that file. And now let's say I am going to delete all the lines except first two lines. Okay, so we now have header and we have only two records. So someone has updated the file. So this updated file, now when a requester request, he is going to read this, or he is going to receive the updated content from this file. So let's run the curl command again and let's see what is the output. You see, now in this case we have received only two records as the output. And also now let's say we want to read any other file. Let's say there is a file called employee_salary.csv. Let's create that file first under tmp directory. So the way to do that is I'm just going to create a file along with the data. So I will use echo command. I will pass some data, so it can be John along with his salary, so whatever. And then let's go to /tmp, and the file name should be employee_salary, which a requester is requesting. So this file must exist here. So we have created a file here, and then you can see the content of the file is John, 2000. So now let's run this curl request, and now you can see the response has been sent back with the content of the data. So this is how you can create a web service in NiFi.